2016 was a disappointment, and 2017 has proven to be a mixed bag. But oh boy, here's what's in store for summer 2018 as we moviegoers remain an optimistic bunch. So kicking things off is Avengers Infinity War, as yes, Disney has called dibs on the official first weekend of summer through 2020. And in 2018, they're likely going to kill an Avenger. My money is on Vision and or Cap. But the real question is whether or not Marvel can finally solve their villain problem if Kate Blanchett doesn't do it already with Thor Ragnarok. And she's supposed to hook up with Thanos, so we'll see. But speaking of Thanos, isn't he still played by Josh Brolin? Yeah, here, at least with Thanos, my money's on no. Then next up, Life of the Party with Melissa McCarthy, who her Sean Spicer impersonation might have made moviegoers momentarily forget Ghostbusters, but can she truly bounce back after that disastrous film? Probably not with this comedy directed by her husband, Ben Falcone. And I think it's great that she's keeping him employed, but man, talk about a ball and chain holding you back. I'm sorry, but it's true. Then Slenderman, and one has to wonder if Sony's Screen Gems has the guts to depict the true horrors that this internet myth has actually inspired, or if it'll just be another by-the-numbers teen horror flick. An all-grown-up Joey King stars while Sylvian White tries to revive his directing career. Then, for Memorial Day weekend, it's the Han Solo movie. And this weekend has proven tricky for Hollywood at the box office. But the last thing this movie needs is more drama. We'll also have to see if moving Star Wars from its very successful December release dates to the end of May, which it's where it's historically opened, is a good idea. Also, Kathleen Kennedy. Let's see if she can make audiences forget about Phil Lord and Chris Miller the way Kevin Feige made them forget about Edgar Wright. But Edgar Wright, the ghost of Edgar Wright, still returned. And I'm sure that Kathleen Kennedy has not heard the last of Lord and Miller. Now we're going to move over to June, which begins with Deadpool 2. And speaking of changes to of release strategy, the Merc with a Mouth is responsible for making February a hot month for movies. But for his sequel, he's going to be competing in the right smack in the middle of the big leagues of summer when it comes to blockbusters. Ooh, that's going to be tough. I don't know if he's... I think he's ready for it, but you never know, right? Especially because Ryan Reynolds has made so many other changes. Yes, like Kathleen Kennedy, he has taken creative ownership here, ousting Tim Miller for John Wick co-director and Atomic Blonde solo director David Leitch. We'll see if he's proven right for such bold choices, or if he gets branded an egomaniac like Robert Downey Jr. has been branded. And I'm sure his RDJ will tell him, it's no fun. He was like, I want to make Iron Man 4, but there doesn't seem to be any interest in it. I want it, but he really did hurt himself, muscling his way into so many other people's movies. First, Civil War. I'm defending myself here because some of you, I'm sure, will be like, what are you talking about? Civil War, which I'll put the article down below in the video description once again. He was only supposed to have a small role in despite the comics, right? And then, of course, he got himself in Spider-Man Homecoming, where he actually doesn't have that big a role. But anyway, the image stuck, unfortunately. Then the next weekend, Transformers 6? Really? I don't think so. I mean, in less than a year, this movie is going to open, even though no deals have been signed, much less they've started shooting. Yeah. So that means Ocean's 8 could have the weekend all to itself, but I think another movie could take this, because we'll see if Gary Ross can succeed where Paul Feig failed, and that's launching an all-female rebrand of a once all-male popular franchise. The high glam will probably help, say what that will about how women are depicted in Hollywood and received. But let's also not forget that Gary Ross might be good at pitching movies. He's a very good high concept guy, but he's not so good at actually making them. He was fired off of Hunger Games and that was his idea, don't forget. So maybe there's hope for Ocean's 8 too. All right, or 16 or whatever they decided to call it. Well, they do 9, 10 then, I guess. Oh, maybe that's how it works. I didn't think of that. They should make that more clear, right? Because it was Ocean's 11, 12, and 13, and this will be 8, 9, and 10. That seems like a lot of work to come up to figure that out. But anyway, you know, it's not going to be a hard sell. The Incredibles 2, which is the next weekend. It shall be glorious. And if not, will Brad Bird get Joss Whedon online? Did the failure of Tomorrowland prepare him or make him more vulnerable. I hope he'd really... Maybe that's why it's taken so long. Maybe he's scared. All right, so the next, Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. I'm sure we're all excited to see what the heck that title means. It's so wordy. But J.A. Bayona will direct. He passed on World War Z2 for this, but David Fincher picked that up. We'll see who made the right choice here. J.A. Bayona is directing a horror take on the Jurassic franchise. He's saying he's returning it to its horror roots, but I don't think Spielberg's was too horrific. Horrorific is the better way to say it. But we'll see what Bayona does here. But Chris Pratt returns, Bryce Dallas Howard, and Jeff Goldblum. Jurassic World haters, resistance is futile. Then the month will close out with supposedly two films. One is Barbie. We'll see. Amy Schumer dropped out on this. Good call, Amy. And maybe Sony should consider doing the same as well and just forget the whole thing. Unless they want to make it a comedy about the new Ken dolls, including Man Bun Ken. That is a real thing. I'm not making that up. Let's see if Phil Lord and Chris Miller are available. And then Tag, which is basically a new version of Dodgeball, right? That movie did okay. And here, Ed Helms organizes a no-holds-barred version of the game in this adult comedy. Isla Fisher, Jeremy Renner, Jake Johnson, speaking of Jurassic World, John Hamm, Annabelle Wallace, and Rashida Jones co-star. So yeah, I would probably see that. And it's also based on a real group of guys as reported in the Wall Street Journal. True story, guys. I love it. Then, July 6th, taking that post-4th of July release date that we've been talking about over on Movie Math, Disney once again has cornered it for Ant-Man and Wasp, where finally a female hero gets billed in the title of a Marvel movie, and it couldn't have happened to a nicer actress. Yes, this is the Robin Laura Petrie of the Avengers. I love it, that so fits. But this sequel, let's see if it can enlarge its box office footprint as the superhero market gets much more competitive. It'll go up against The Spy Who Dumped Me from ABC Family writer-director Susanna Fogel, making the jump to the big screen with this high-concept relationship comedy. And we'll see if being the vengeful ex of a spy is as lucrative for Mila Kunis as being a bad mom. Her best friend will be played by Kate McKinnon, who sure is funny and wins a lot of Emmys for Saturday Night Live, but so far has been the kiss of death when it comes to feature films. And then forget Christmas in July. How about Halloween in July with this next weekend as we have Hotel Transylvania 3, as Sony Animation inexplicably moves it from September where it's been very successful. And also James Wan further expands the Conjuring cinematic universe with The Nun. Those could actually both do well. But Dwayne Johnson's going to try and get some of you to come over to see his new movie Skyscraper as he also tries to prove that he's still got it post-Baywatch and I'm guessing post-Jumanji. This is a Chinese co-production and his best bet to recreating his San Andreas success, if he can. Then, Alita Battle Angel. Audiences had a real problem with whitewashing, but how about Latino washing? Is it okay if you swap one non-white ethnicity for another? And also, is Robert Rodriguez still trying to prove how cheap he can make movies instead of how well he can make movies? We get it! You own a green screen! Move on! Also, I would say the DCEU has proven that it's better to shoot on location. Green screens aren't all they're cracked up to be. The movie does have an all-star supporting cast, though, like wow, and James Cameron is heavily involved. So maybe this manga adaptation can succeed where Ghost in the Shell failed so spectacularly. I'm thinking no, but I have to see a trailer. It's also going up against Mamma Mia, Here We Go Again, so Meryl Streep could potentially sing that other movie to death. Don't underestimate one of the longest-running shows ever, both on London's West End and Broadway, plus the second-highest-grossing film worldwide ever directed by a woman after Wonder Woman, which just recently unseated it. Then the month closes out with Mission Impossible 6, which people were super excited about until The Mummy came out. But still, Mission Impossible Rogue Nation was so good, and the gang is back together yet again. And this time, that includes the woman. Two of them, no less. Whoa, making up for lost female representation there, Cruise and Macquarie. Nice. Although Jeremy Renner's not returning. He's too busy making Tag. But he's being replaced by Stash Superman. Come on, that's going to get your ticket money right there. Now, August, the first weekend of August, has become a premiere release date. But this year, it's going to be competitive as well, as we have three movies currently sitting here. We'll see, maybe one will blink. The first is Holmes and Watson, reteaming Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly. They've never let us down. And what is not only a spoof of Sherlock Holmes, but maybe of the popular BBC version of the legend, that would be fantastic. It might be wishful thinking, though, on our part. Then there's Predator, with Shane Black returning to the films that he once had a supporting role in, but everybody loved it. And here he's assembled a diverse cast of up-and-coming talent, including Logan's Boyd Holbrook, Moonlight's Trevante Rhodes. Let's see what he's got. He was very quiet in Moonlight. TV's Sterling K. Brown and social media darling. Not to mention Room's Jacob Tremblay. Can all this snark break the remake curse that we currently have going? I hope so. And then a Madea family funeral. This is hot off of Boo, Madea Halloween, which, get this, has a sequel that's being fast-tracked for this Halloween. So by the time Funeral hits, there will have been two Madea Halloweens. And the first one was pretty darn good. Here, Madea and her crew will travel to, their words, not mine, backwoods Georgia, for a funeral which reveals unsavory family secrets. Is there any other kind with Madea? Again, the first Boo was a lot of fun, so if Boo 2 doesn't break the streak, this could do very well as well. Then, the next weekend, this is just becoming too competitive. There are four movies here. One of them's going to move. And there's space in August. One of them could definitely move and should. So, Amusement Park, my money's on this moving. This is a Paramount animated movie where a little girl goes to a magical amusement park full of animals, and she's apparently voiced also by Mila Kunis. So, is that Meg? And there's another movie called Meg that's coming up in just a second. But anyway, have they learned nothing from Disney? Animal Kingdom is not a popular theme park. Anyway, Meg. But this isn't about Mila Kunis's Meg. This is, hold on to your butts. If you think you like shark movies, this is a shark movie with Jason Statham. And he's gonna save Chinese scientists. Ka-ching! It's fabulous. Then also, The Nightingale is slated to come out this weekend, which you could also see, but are less likely to, where TV director Michelle MacLaren finally gets to direct a movie, this time about two French sisters on the eve of World War II. Wow! Shouldn't have pitched that talking tiger for Wonder Woman, huh, MacLaren? That's sad. But then Scarface could be a real contender. David Ayer's remake, you know, they keep remaking Scarface to represent new eras in crime in the United States. It's a great idea. They're always good movies. And David Ayer, though, luckily is not scripting. The Coen brothers have co-scripted here, so that's encouraging, although they don't always hit the target either. But this is Diego Luna's reward for Rogue One, so I think we should support it. I'm very excited. Then Captive State. This sounds ridiculous, but it's actually quite intriguing. It stars John Goodman and Vera Farmiga, and is directed by Rise of the Planet of the Apes director Rupert Wyatt before he just totally messed up his career, making that horrible Mark Wahlberg movie, The Gambler, bailing on Gambit, but he's back, and this is hopefully a smart sci-fi movie that imagines a futuristic Chicago occupied by aliens. Gattaca meets District 9. I'm down for it, especially after John Goodman's fabulous turn in 10 Cloverfield Lane. And then it wouldn't be August if it didn't close out with a C-horror movie. And this year, that's Cadaver. Ooh, poor Stena Katic. This is what life looks like post-Castle. No wonder her fans fought so hard for her. Nathan Fillion's must be like, whew, that's going to be a bad weekend for me on social media. Talking about social media blowback. But anyway, that's summer 2018 as it currently looks. I did not include dates that have been earmarked for unspecified projects, but there are some slated, so expect some announcements over the next couple of months, and of course for some of these movies to move. So write down below what movies you're excited for, which you plan to avoid, and of course you can always check out some more videos right now.